Well, thank you for inviting me here. Dear friends, my contribution will present the view from Greece. The case of Greek Euroscepticism does present a special interest. Greece used to be one of the most, often the most, pro-EU country. During the decades of 1990s and 2000. As far as a positive or negative opinion towards the EU was expressed. And that picture has changed dramatically since the onset of the debt crisis of Greece and the fiscal adjustment programs that followed. Actually, there has been a complete reversal of the picture, with Greece now being at the top of the countries with an unfavorable opinion of the EU. On the other hand, this dramatic reversal does not really translate itself into a willingness to withdraw from the EU. The distinction between hard Euroscepticism, that is a principled opposition to the European integration itself, and soft Euroscepticism, that is the opposition to certain forms that this integration has taken, is absolutely essential in any attempt to understand Greek attitudes towards the EU. Actually, the title of one of the most thorough scientific surveys of the Greek people's attitude towards the EU summarizes it well. It says, "We no longer love you, but we don't want to leave you." So in Greece, we have the great reversal. Prior to the crisis, Greece was one of the most pro-EU and actually pro-integration countries in Europe. At the Eurobarometer surveys, the answer, "I tend to trust the EU integration," averaged about 65%, all the way from 1993 up to 2008, 65%. "Tend to not to trust" was just as at 15% in 1993. So the reversal is very impressive, because at the end of 2016, the tend to trust answer was just 28% from 65%. And the tend not to trust the EU rose from 15% to 71%. Even according to the Global Attitudes 2006 Service of Pew Research Center, the Greeks have by now become the most skeptical people in Europe towards further integration, even more than the British. And also, they are the most unfavorable to the EU, again by 71%. And quite understandably, they also vehemently reject the EU's economic policies. That's 92%. To further nuance this picture, there is a recent research that points to the formation of two relatively hardcore and cohesive camps that are almost equal in force, in strength. Hardcore Eurosceptics and hardcore Europhiles seem to be around 20%. But in any case, criticism to the EU policies does not lead to a withdrawalist attitude, as in the case of Britain, for example. Greek Euroscepticism is soft, objecting to certain forms of the EU integration project, especially the Eurozone policies. But again, this Eurozone skepticism, as all polls have shown, does not translate itself to a majoritarian support of withdrawal from the Eurozone, a Brexit, a monetary Brexit. Well, the respective attitudes of the Greek parties are also illuminating in this aspect. There is only one parliamentary party that opposes Greece's participation in the European Union, that is the Communist Party of Greece. But even in this case, the Communist Party are not calling for an immediate withdrawal, but a cautious one after the establishment of a socialist transformation, a socialist regime. Characteristically, the Greek communists reject also a withdrawal from the Eurozone without first a prior popular and socialist control and transformation of the economy. Golden Dawn, the fascist group, the fascist party in Greece, also has a Eurosceptic attitude, but it comes out more ambivalent and vague, actually opportunistic, concerning participation in the EU, and more clearly negative regarding participation in the Eurozone. a clear anti-EU position calling for immediate withdrawal can only be found at small extreme left parties or anti-EU parties that actually are not represented in the parliament. On the other hand, Syriza's position presents a peculiarity that is quite representative actually of the Greek people's attitude. The initial form of the party at the beginning of the 1990s, when it was Synaspismos, that's coalition of the left, was fervently left Europeanist, very much supportive of the EU integration project, and even voted for the ratification of the Maastricht Treaty. This position has seen a gradual change. Since the early 2000, the decade of 2000, Synaspismos led a wider left front in Greece, opposing neoliberal globalization, while exactly at the same moment the neoliberal character of the EU was becoming all the more pronounced, especially in competition and internal market policies. At 2008, Synaspismos denounced its vote for the ratification of the Maastricht Treaty 15 years before. Syriza, which is the successor party to Synaspismos, became all the more critical to the Lisbon Treaty, the Fiscal Compact, the Stability and Growth Pact, as treaties that actually constitutionalized austerity and neoliberal policies. What is noteworthy is that Syriza and a part of the European left try to combine both a strong criticism of the present form of the EU policies and also an aspiration for a European front against neoliberalism. They stand not for the cancellation of the EU integration, but for another form of that same integration. Nevertheless, what is interesting here is that the backtracking of Syriza in 2008 regarding the formative and the decisive Maastricht Treaty met with a simultaneous shift in the Greek public opinion that was gradually also turning to Euroscepticism. A defining moment in the short history of Greek Euroscepticism was the referendum of July 2015. Of course, it was never a referendum on the EU, on Eurozone, or either on Eurozone participation. But it was set in that terms by the yes camp, supporting the camp that was supporting the acceptance of the institutional's proposal as a necessary price to pay for full participation in the EU. That referendum was a major formative force for the creation of more cohesive and conscious camps opposing or supporting EU and Eurozone policies. Another marked effect of the July referendum and the September elections that followed soon after was the realization that Syriza actually expresses two currents in the Greek public opinion. A left Europeanism, obviously by now less enthusiastic, less naive, but still dedicated to an anti-austerity reform of the EU. And that is especially the case with Syriza's leadership. And let me add here also that Yanis Varoufakis and the DM movement also represent exactly the same argument. And at the same time, Syriza represents a large part of the Greek electorate that has a highly critical attitude on the EU, and some of them actually nurture the idea of a perhaps negotiated and organized withdrawal from the Eurozone, which is very difficult to measure how many of them support that, because it depends on the way the question is posed and the guarantees proposed, the plan, etc. In a way, this was the legacy of the referendum. Syriza and Alexis Tsipras were the leaders of the no camp. And although they capitulated, they seem to have forged a certain relation of trust with the Greek Eurosceptic camp. To help us better understand these apparent contradictions of the Greek public opinion, criticism of the EU but not withdrawal, fierce criticism of the Eurozone but rejection of a Grexit, large majority of Greeks always reject exiting the Eurozone, we should take some steps back, perhaps, because there are certain domestic peculiarities of Greece that we need to explain. Any attempt at an explanation should take account of the symbolic as well as the strategic and the utilitarian aspect of Greece's relation to the EU. On the one hand, participation in the EU is seen as a guarantee of modernization and democratization. Greece is a low-quality government, a low-quality of government country. Trust in the European institutions, especially the European courts, for example, was traditionally higher than the respective trust in domestic institutions. The EU was and is seen, even today, as a protection against the arbitrariness, the corruption, or the cronyism of the Greek elites. That was a very strong attitude, especially in the 1980s and 1990s, but still survives today. On the other hand, participation in the EU, and especially in the European Economic Community before that, was based on a trade-off that is which effects are actually irreversible. Greece handed over the protection of its industries in exchange for the EU structural funds. Greece used to have, before entering the EEC, an import substituting industry that was relatively successful domestically. Against the Northern European competition, although in a single market, this industry was doomed. In exchange, Greece secured extensive funding to modernize its production and its administration. That kind of policy created a heavy dependence of the Greek economy, the Greek society, and the party system on EU funding. It was inconceivable for any government to endanger this relation, especially since that would directly affect the extensive clientelistic networks of the socialists and the conservatives that actually controlled the distribution of the EU funds. Furthermore, and as a consequence of the above, the Greek people's relation with the EU's policies and politics was always shallow. Participation in the EU was seen as economically indispensable, as symbolically reassuring, and geopolitically vital also. Greece considers EU participation as an asset in a dangerous neighborhood. Therefore, no Greek party, with the exception of the Communists, was ever willing to engage in any serious debate on the pros or the cons of the EU, to propose a referendum, and finally to position itself on a pro or against the EU divide. From the Maastricht Treaty up to the Lisbon Treaty, all of them passed through the Parliament with a minimum of debate and disagreement. So, where do we go from here? The EU is ruled through a peculiar mix of federalist and intergovernmental institutions, with the second always having the upper hand on all major decisions. But intergovernmentalism is governance by the national governments that are supposed to deliberate on an equal basis. Of course, this does not apply at intergovernmental decision-making bodies like the European Council. Each state's relative power is decisive. International power relations re-enter the scene, the political scene of the EU. But when stronger states impose themselves on weaker ones, national pride is traumatized and Euroscepticism grows stronger. Federalists and left Europeanists have been pushing for the deepening of federal and democratic institutions that will rein in the power of national governments, and B, for the introduction of policies that will promote the identification of the European peoples with positive aspects of the EU, like Europe-wide unemployment insurance, guaranteed income, common taxation, common allowances. Unfortunately, this project will inevitably hurt upon another source of Euroscepticism shared by all European peoples: racism and stereotypes. A culturally determined mistrust that goes both ways between north and south of Europe, but also between west and east of Europe. I finish. So, solidarity is often evoked as a prerequisite for moving Europe forward. But solidarity presupposes trust. What we have seen these recent years was a reintroduction of a common theme of neoliberal ideology. The rich deserve their wealth, they are worth it, they work for it. The poor, they just pay the price of their own bad habits. The same discourse, enriched with a cultural, ethnic dimension, dominated much of the commentary on the Eurozone crisis. So the undeserving poor became the undeserving southern poor. No mention was ever done of the structural problems of the Eurozone or different starting points, for example, for every country's industry, or productivity, or even policies, political systems. Therefore, and I'm closing this, my presentation, any European project should work intensively on challenging cultural prejudices and stereotypes among Europeans, on familiarizing European peoples with each other's societies and national peculiarities. I thank you.